on BBC Radio 5 Sports Extra.
Welcome back to Mexico City, where we are poised and ready for F1 qualifying for the Mexican Grand Prix, round 19, and it is just a few moments away on a very pleasant day in Mexico. Just 25 degrees air temperature and a small chance of rain, 10% chance of rain for this session. But overall, a very nice day at the Autodromo Hermanos Rodriguez. And once again, I'm Julian Palmer, and I'm joined by sports car champ Alex Brundle and chief F1 writer for the BBC. It's Andrew Benson. And guys, we're ready for a packed crowd and a very, very interesting session.
This is it. Back to the traditional qualifying setup this weekend in Mexico. Around 4.3 kilometres of circuit. The venue holding the Mexican Grand Prix for the 23rd time. And it's going to be a mixed-up session. We've seen so much intrigue throughout the free practices around what is a very quirky layout, a very interesting ambient to be holding a Formula One Grand Prix. Max Verstappen, the clear favourite, but it's been nip and tuck at the front of the field.
Nip and tuck. Verstappen quickest through all three practices. Lando Norris was quick yesterday, but Andrew Benson, the interloper, the wild card, dare we say it, might just be Alex Albon in the Williams, who was rapid earlier.
It seems extraordinary to say it, doesn't it? His best qualifying position this year is fourth in Holland. You know, you wouldn't think the Williams would be quick around Mexico City. He didn't think the Williams would be quick around Mexico City, but second in first practice yesterday, second in final practice earlier today. Could he beat his own career best to get into the top three? It sounds outlandish, but it looks possible.
Just two drivers dipped below a 1 minute 18 second lap in practice earlier on. Verstappen, 17.8, was 0.07 quicker than Albon, the former teammate, separated by not very much. Sergio Perez on home soil has a bit of pressure. He's got a huge expectation on his shoulders around this place. He always does in Mexico. It is a packed grandstand ready to greet him, and they've already been cheering him all weekend long. And Perez was third quickest earlier on, has form around this circuit, was on the podium last year. How do you reckon he'd be feeling? Home race, bit of pressure now, second in the championship, the fight's still on. Nervous or excited?
Hopefully buoyed by the huge crowd here. Mexico City, a conurbation of 22 million people. He's the hometown hero. There are massive Sergio Perez helmets touring the town, promoting his participation in the Grand Prix. And you can just hear the crowd behind him. He needs a good result here. And I'm really hoping that the pressure is not going to get to him and he's going to be able to deliver it. He certainly does have the car to do that, and has been very close to Max Verstappen throughout this race weekend so far, even if he's not that close in the championship at large.
Mixed qualifying results for Sergio Perez this year. Probably polite, really, way of saying it, when his teammates had 10 pole positions so far. Sergio Perez, who won a couple of races earlier on in the season, looked to be a man that could challenge Max Verstappen for the title. He hasn't. Verstappen has 466 points, and he is a triple world champion ahead of his teammate, still in second on 240 points. The battle now is for second in the championship. Perez on 240 points, Hamilton 201 after he was disqualified last Sunday in Austin, out of second place, opened up the gap. And this is a big test for Mercedes as well. Both Mercedes and McLaren hoping to be fighting for the podium places. Maybe, dare we say, trying to get on the front row, challenge Verstappen.
It's been on and off throughout this weekend for Mercedes. Hamilton in the final practice having a little more difficult time than George Russell. It's going to be interesting to see what they can do. Hamilton been saying throughout the weekend the car not feeling anywhere near as good as it did back at the Circuit of the Americas just 1 week ago. So they're not getting that same positive feeling that put Hamilton second on the road in the Texan race, but obviously disqualified afterwards.
I think the great thing about this qualifying session is I think we pretty much all know who's going to be on pole position. But after that, it's like, who's going to be where? Ferrari, how quick are they? We don't know after two blocking incidents in final practice. Mercedes have looked quick and looked slow. McLaren looked quick yesterday, slow this morning. Aston Martin, well, they look like they've dropped off the planet from their form earlier in the season. But out of those top four teams, it could be anyone behind Verstappen.
That's the story of 2023. In short, from Andrew Benson right there. Who can finish behind Max Verstappen? Can anyone topple the Dutchman today? 26-year-old Max Verstappen, who has dominated this season, looking for his 11th pole from 19 qualifyings. He's won 15 of 18 Grand Prix. He's won here 4 of the last 5 Grand Prix as well. And he is in strong form and is certainly the man to beat as we go green light for Q1. And straight out onto the circuit goes Kevin Magnussen in the Haas. He has the track to himself momentarily at the start of Q1. With 17 minutes and 36, 35, 34 seconds remaining. And still just Kevin Magnussen on circuit. Pierre Gasly now comes out behind him. Two cars on track, trying to get 3 runs in potentially at the start of this one. 18 minutes on the clock and counting down.
Those having a difficult weekend, as is customary, very much out first. Pierre Gasly and Ocon have both been struggling in that Alpine. Kevin Magnussen and Nico Hülkenberg in the Haas have been fast in the speed traps, but slow pretty much everywhere else throughout the weekend, even over a one lap format where the Haas tends to be stronger than it is in race conditions. They're out there getting those early laps in and perhaps prioritising this Q1 session. Teams with a few more tyres to play with this weekend, that's because Pirelli have been supplying test tyres, which teams have been using to basically keep the car off the floor throughout free practice, and has allowed them to reload their tyre allocation and use a few more throughout practice. A lot of running on the soft.
That was the rumble of the Aston Martin of Lance Stroll, who joins the fray as well. Another driver, Alex, that's been struggling. Another team that's been struggling so far this weekend. Aston Martin on the back foot, and they've gone straight out. Alonso joins his teammate and makes it 4 cars on track in the opening couple of minutes here.
Yeah, been nowhere city, haven't they? All throughout the weekend, both Stroll and Alonso saw him backwards in FP2, the Spaniard, and does not look to be behaving underneath them as they continue to struggle with that Aston Martin. First taker for a flying lap then, you can hear him heading into turn one. It's K-Mag in the Haas.
Bounces over the apex curve of turn two. The first section of this track, the first sector is just 3 corners. It's a chicane made of 3 parts, a right, left and a right, and then a long straight up to the second chicane, turns 4 and 5, where Magnussen is out now in the Haas. The Dane comes through uninterrupted by Fernando Alonso, who he sweeps around and enters a double apex turn 6. Right-hander followed immediately by a second apex right-hander, and a very quick sequence now at turn 7. A left-hander flashes through the apex of the right-hander of turn 8, blends out of the throttle through 9, scoops it up through turns 10 and 11, the exit of the left. And now with Magnussen, this is the sound of him approaching the tightest section of the circuit.
Focusing in on this Q1 session that they failed to get both cars out of for plenty of races. Only once in the last 10 races have they managed to achieve that. That was back in Singapore, but K-Mag, purple in all sectors, the first man, of course, to get through and start a flying lap, but is already being ousted by Pierre Gasly, who's on a lap in the Alpine just behind. Lance Stroll and Fernando Alonso, we also expect across the line in relatively short order, but still in the early running here in Q1.
Certainly not an exceptional time on the board at all for Magnussen. 1 minute 19.7 is the early benchmark, and there's Gasly, Alonso, Stroll on flying laps now, trying to do something about it as some of the other cars filter out onto the circuit. You can hear the cheers. Guess who's out there? Into the fray goes Sergio Perez, and the crowd are off their seats already down at the first couple of corners. The man who's got a bit more pressure than usual this weekend. Perez on an outlap in the Red Bull. Verstappen is headed out onto circuit now as well. George Russell and Yuki Tsunoda out on track. Lando Norris comes out, and they're on the soft tyres apart from Norris and Russell, who have opted to go onto a set of mediums to start this one.
It's interesting. We've seen proximity, and I did wonder if anybody was going to try that. We've seen proximity between the soft and the medium in terms of the performance of the tyre throughout the weekend so far. The soft tyre looking very edgy, moving around on the compound and overheating underneath the drivers. It is the softest tyre available in Formula One that's been brought this weekend, the C5 tyre. So some drivers clearly thinking they're going to be able to make it through this session perhaps on that medium tyre, given the proximity of the medium to the soft. So you've got Russell, Piastri, Norris and Lewis Hamilton, that's both McLarens and both Mercedes, trying out the medium early on.
Yep. Using up a set of the yellow-walled medium tyre. The other drivers out there on the soft that'll give them more grip at most stages, any stage of Formula One, one lap pace, but of course in race trim, not the case. And Perez now starts a flying lap. We're still waiting to see Albon, Bottas, Ricciardo, Sergeant Joe, Leclerc, Sainz, the two Ferraris, Hülkenberg and Ocon grace the circuit at all with 13 minutes remaining. Andrew?
And Geraldine, if you want a demonstration of just how far Aston Martin have fallen from the heady heights of the first half of the season when Alonso got six podiums, I think it was, in eight races, he's just set his fastest, his first lap. He's only a tenth faster than Kevin Magnussen's Haas. It's incredible.
It's very dismal times at the moment. So the first four that went out on circuit are Alonso, Magnussen, Gasly and Stroll, and they are the top four in that order. But the times are pretty slow for the first flying lap. They are not really any quicker than the drivers managed in practice earlier on. So they will tumble the times. The track will clean up. And Sergio Perez has done the fastest first sector of anyone in the Red Bull.
Making his way through the middle sector, the Mexican driver. Just trying to get these early laps in. Just trying to avoid any kind of mishap in this early stage of qualifying. They know their work's to come much later. Max Verstappen sets the purple first sector, slightly quicker than Perez, but listen to the roar of the crowd as he makes his way through the baseball stadium and applies the throttle through the exit on what should be a routine run through the final corner. A second up for Perez on the previous benchmark set by Fernando Alonso. 118.5 is what the Mexican's able to achieve.
So that's a much more sensible time for Perez, who goes top. Yuki Tsunoda goes second, just 0.3 away from the Mexican. Here's the sound on board with George Russell, who exits the final corner in the Mercedes on the medium tyre, and he goes 0.3 down on Perez. So it's Perez, Tsunoda and Russell, then a big gap back to Alonso, Magnussen, Gasly and Stroll, who are already back in the pits and getting ready for a second set of tyres. And Max Verstappen comes through and dips us down to a 1 minute 18.1. Goes top of the times, but as a reminder, top earlier on in practice was Verstappen on a 1 minute 17.8.
Norris has just ditched his first lap as Lewis Hamilton goes up to third place on the medium. So he's managing to get within a half a second of the pace of Verstappen there on the medium tyre. But Lando Norris has thought better of it on that first lap on the medium tyre and ditched it. His teammate Piastri has chosen to finish the lap and slots in sixth.
Now that's an interesting lap time from Hamilton, Alex, isn't it? Because Russell only gained 0.4 on the, from the medium to the soft in practice this morning. Or earlier today, I should say. And so, you know, if Hamilton can... 0.4 is not very much. So in theory, Hamilton has got a shot at maybe even getting into that sort of Verstappen area, even though I sort of hesitate to say it a bit.
Half a second back for Lewis Hamilton. So he is in proximity, potentially. We'll have to see what the difference is when the fuel loads are low and they're really pushing for it. First of the Alfa Romeos across the line to start a flying lap. That's in the shape of Valtteri Bottas, who's been strong all weekend long.
17 cars out there on circuit then. 10 minutes and 20 seconds left in Q1 and Bottas starts a flying lap. It's a busy circuit. 18 cars now out on track. Only Perez, who's in second place, and Lando Norris, who aborted a first lap on a medium, are waiting in the pits. The rest of the drivers out there, 4.3-kilometre circuit, busy. Traffic was an issue earlier on in practice as well, and that is going to be difficult, particularly, Alex, in that middle sector.
Yeah, middle sector unsighted for the drivers. Difficult between the curbs. We saw both Ferraris tripping over the Haas of Kevin Magnussen and the Aston Martin of Lance Stroll and not getting their laps in free practice three. No such issues so far. Valtteri Bottas climbing, though, all over the curbs of turn seven, turn eight and turn nine, trying to take the most out of an Alfa Romeo that looks reinvigorated this weekend with a DRS open, screaming down into turn 12 in the final sector.
Bottas going well, and he has been all weekend. He's 0.2 down on Verstappen into the final sector. Daniel Ricciardo also flying this weekend. He's the fastest man of all in sector one. And we should note Yuki Tsunoda, his teammate in the other AlphaTauri, will start tomorrow's Grand Prix from the back of the grid. Whatever happens, they've changed power unit components and Tsunoda is resigned to starting at the back, but he's out there trying to do his best at the moment. This is the sound of his teammate, the Australian Daniel Ricciardo, getting on the gas, coming towards the apex of turn 17, keeping it tight to the line, and Ricciardo jumps up to second place. So it's Verstappen, Ricciardo, Bottas in third now, Perez, Hamilton, Tsunoda, Russell, Zhou up to eight, Piastri 9th, Alonso 10th, Magnussen, Gasly, Stroll, and Albon jumps up to 9th now in the Williams, but some 1.2 seconds adrift.
Disappointing for Albon, who was second in Free Practice 3 earlier on and has been very much the star of the show, putting the laps in that Williams. And here we can see in our commentary box that the Daniel Ricciardo has been given a tow, just as they practiced earlier on in the weekend, between Daniel Ricciardo and Yuki Tsunoda, which could well have led to that great lap time.
Certainly the first sector time where Ricciardo is the quickest, or was the quickest, because now Logan Sargeant in the Williams has gone fastest of all in the first sector. 8 minutes left of Q1. Drivers returning to the pits. There's still 15 of them out on track. The Ferraris are getting a time on the board. Interesting also on the medium tyre. So in this first run, the Ferraris, the McLarens and the Mercedes, conventionally the challengers to Verstappen, have gone out and used a set of mediums. Sainz goes to sixth. Leclerc is on a flyer at the moment, and he crosses the line, jumps up to third. So decent lap there for Charles Leclerc on the mediums.
Yeah, they've certainly snatched it back, haven't they, at least at this stage. And on that medium tyre, if they're able to use it to get through this stage of qualifying, of course, it offers them softs that they can play with later on. It's quite a short lap in terms of time here in Mexico City, only at a 1:18 so far, so could potentially offer the opportunity for more runs later on in qualifying if they can hold the softs back.
At the moment, in the elimination zone, Alex Albon has shuffled down to 16th as Ocon gets himself to 13th. So it's Albon who just peels into the pits now and will get ready for a final run. Piastri, Sargeant and Norris, who's in the pits and hasn't gone back out after that early foray. And Lance Stroll is just dropped down into the drop zone as well. So Stroll, Albon, Piastri, Sargeant and Norris, two McLarens, two Williams and Lance Stroll in the drop zone. 7 minutes left on the clock and the pit lane is starting to fill up now. Drivers have completed their first runs. We're going to have one final flourish with a few minutes to go.
What an interesting group of drivers who are out of it. Both the McLarens are very half-baked run on the medium for each of them. Piastri's just a little bit off the pace. Norris didn't even bother to finish the lap. And then both Williams, who've been very much in the action throughout the whole of free practice, just not appearing to have the pace at this stage. Lance Stroll, perhaps a driver who's not got out of Q3 here for the last 3 years, last three iterations of the Grand Prix, will be the driver who we expect to see out in Q1.
Also worth pointing out that Fernando Alonso has already done two new sets of soft tyre runs. And he's moved up to 8th place with his second run, which is much more competitive from him.
As has Lance Stroll, down in 16th. Stroll has done the same run plan as Alonso at the moment, and Alonso's got himself up into the top 10. Stroll down in 16th position. And that is the sound of Lando Norris being released once again in the McLaren. So whatever caused him to pit, he's okay.
Can you check the floor?
Okay, copy that, we're checking.
Now the voice of Logan Sargeant, who we see bouncing over the curbs in the turns 7 and 8, ricocheting the floor across the aggressive curbs.
Yeah, traffic with Hamilton in the sector. That was a bit too much from Hamilton.
And that is the team radio of Carlos Sainz, who has a complain about Lewis Hamilton getting in the way in the final set. That didn't look like a lot in that for me.
No, he's been in the walls all weekend, had a very big spin in FP3 trying to avoid the rear of Lance Stroll's Aston Martin. Was very unhappy with Stroll as well, gave him a big hip and shoulder down towards turn 12, and a lot of pyrotechnics on the radio from Sainz. So he's very much bothered by the traffic around here.
It's easy to get caught up in it. In the middle sector, it's difficult to jump out of the way. You've got to have very good communication with your race engineer. And so far, everyone seems to be doing okay at it. But Hamilton, he got out of the way. He peeled to the right-hand side as Sainz came into the stadium section. I don't think he could have done a huge amount more there. So Lewis Hamilton in sixth. The order with 4.5 minutes to go is Verstappen, Ricciardo, Leclerc, Bottas, Perez. Then it's Hamilton, Sainz, Alonso, Tsunoda, Russell, your top 10. Gasly, 11th. Ahead of Hülkenberg, Zhou, Ocon, Magnussen, and in the drop zone as we head down to the final runs is Lance Stroll, Alex Albon in the Williams, then Oscar Piastri, Lando Norris, the two McLarens under pressure at this stage, and then Logan Sargeant, who had a huge moment in the middle sector.
And it's been a moment as well for Alexander Albon running wide through the exit curb of turn 12, which gets underneath the plank and causes the car to skid along it, losing traction. So it looks like a moment for both Williams, as Oscar Piastri in his McLaren is the first man for his last lap of Q1. Here we go then. Piastri under pressure, down in 18th position. Both McLarens under pressure here. They've got to dig out a lap. And we know this is a very capable car. But as Piastri hits the brakes for the left-hander at turn four, he's 1/10 down on Kevin Magnussen, who's currently on the bubble in 15th. He brakes, enters turn six, a fairly routine 180-degree double apex right-hander, and now heads toward the middle sector. It's not been a great start to the lap for Lando Norris either, who's running behind Piastri. He is starting to improve now, but the early microsectors were not good. This McLaren coming on through the lap. Alexander Albon improving, but not setting the world alight in the Williams, a little bit further down the road from Norris.
Fastest middle sector of anyone, though, for Piastri. The McLaren starting to come towards the drivers.
Okay, there are so many people out here. Are we okay time-wise?
Yep, should be okay on time.
That's the sound of Lewis Hamilton. There's less than 3 minutes to go in Q1. The drivers are now starting to head out. Hamilton's actually still in the pit, so he's wondering, why are we not getting out there? Piastri crosses the line, jumps up to P2, and it is bedlam at the end of the pit lane.
Absolute bedlam at the end of the pit lane, with Lewis Hamilton parked up and waiting. Alexander Albon comes across the line, only P9, but it will be enough in the Williams. So Lando Norris is the driver that we're waiting for in the McLaren, who looks slow across the line.
Norris has backed off in the final sector, and he is going to be under huge pressure with just time for one more flying lap to go. He'll pass a stream of cars coming out of the pit lane on out laps now as well. It's a very, very busy circuit. All the cars are out or heading out for one final lap, 4.3 kilometres, with 20 cars jostling for position, and all the time they were queuing up there at the end of the pit, they would have been cooling the tyres as well, so not ideal preparation.
It was a huge moment for Norris on the exit curb of turn eight, bouncing the McLaren and having a huge slide in the mid-corner. He's had to throw that lap away.
It was a big moment. So a lot of drivers struggling through the middle sector of the lap. That seems to be the one catching the drivers out. At the moment in the drop zone, then, with Piastri improving, it is Ocon, Magnussen, Stroll, Norris and Sargeant still down there. Albon jumped up to ninth. Here's his radio.
Guys, the tyres are completely gone. Completely different car.
The Albon hype train is coming to a little bit of a halt right now. He's okay at the moment in ninth, but the times are so close. From Hamilton in seventh, there is only 3.5 tenths down to the drop zone.
Cruising into the station in a cloud of steam, isn't it? The hype train for Albon as Stroll goes into T1.
Yeah, you've really got to be hooking up this final lap now. The margins are so tight. The traffic is really, really all over the place. Piastri and Ricciardo, second and third, are back in the pits, and Albon pits as well. So he's done as much as he can, the Williams driver in ninth, and he will hope that there's not a flurry of improvements out there, but there is everyone behind him out pushing or on an outlap ready to find a little bit of pace. Lance Stroll not finding it though in the first sector. He's not improving, and nor is Kevin Magnussen, and those two, 17th and 18th, have got to find something on this lap.
They certainly do. 40 seconds left on the clock. We do have an incident out on circuit. That's down in sector one. Max Verstappen has been noted for pit lane impeding, so plenty going on out there. We'll see how this final flurry of laps come through with only 25 seconds to go. Who's going to get across the line here?
There's a yellow flag in sector one, and it may be Fernando Alonso, who's come to a stop on the exit of turn three. The yellow flag is still out, so drivers are not able to improve at this stage. The bottom five is Ocon, Magnussen, Stroll. Lando Norris is 19th and is coming through a yellow flag zone, and I don't think Norris is going to be able to improve here. No, he's not. He's backed off, and Norris is going to be out in Q1. The McLaren driver, 19th without a time on the board. Can anyone improve? I'm not sure they can. This is the sound of Fernando Alonso.
No, so many drivers were stuck in that first sector. We had Ocon, Magnussen and Stroll all stuck in that first sector in the yellow flag zone. And I can't see significant improvements now for these drivers in the drop zone.
Esteban Ocon is improving. He's managed to come through as Alonso's got going. So Alonso had a very lazy, bizarre looking spin, the Aston Martin, at turn three.
Absolutely right, JP. Ocon and Sargeant, both on better laps at this stage. Sargeant gets across the line. It is not enough for the American driver to improve.
So it's Ocon now into the final sector, into the baseball stadium. Esteban Ocon in 16th position in the Alpine. It's Ocon or Zhou who are looking to improve. Magnussen is out, Stroll is out, Norris is now 20th and last, and Esteban Ocon comes across the line. Can he improve? Can he get into the top 15? No, he cannot. To the tune of 3/10, he is also out. So that's it.
No further driver improvement. So it will be Ocon, Magnussen, Stroll, Sargeant and Norris. There is an investigation under the way for Max Verstappen at the end of the pit lane impeding other drivers. So there will be a discussion with the result with regards to that. George Russell now also being noted as an investigation for impeding at the end of the pit lane. Remember Singapore, when there was this issue with Max Verstappen parking at the end of the pit lane, the discussion with regards to whether he could, well, that's going to be discussed again after qualifying.
I'll tell you what, in that incident in Singapore, there were three separate incidents involving Verstappen in Singapore, and lots of people in the paddock were very surprised that he didn't get a penalty for at least one of them. Here's some radio.
Why are we going behind a million cars, man?
Yeah, I understood, Logan. The traffic was tough on that outlap.
Okay, that is the voice in the team radio of Logan Sargeant. Just to recap, the five drivers out at the end of Q1 are Esteban Ocon, Kevin Magnussen, Lance Stroll and Lando Norris out in 19th position now because Logan Sargeant has had his lap time deleted for track limits, but 19th and no sensible time on the board for Norris. He is the big scalp going out in Q1. That is not what the McLaren driver had in mind when he turned up this weekend. Logan Sargeant is off the back with no time on the board at all either, and Norris jumps out of the car. That is a short session for him. Went out on the mediums, didn't put a time on the board, and paid the price when he made a mistake on that first run on the softs.
Well, teammate Piastri up in second place, so that shows where that car is capable of being. They put all the pressure on the drivers, not giving them a lap early on. The medium tyre not fast enough for either McLaren driver. They were both in the drop zone. And then Oscar Piastri manages to find a lap late in the session. Lando Norris, though, with that big swapper in the middle of turn eight, and it's cost him everything on this qualifying Saturday.
And that is because Fernando Alonso had a spin. So Alonso was starting a flying lap, spun coming down to turn three.
Always on the wrong side of it, it's unbelievable. Always.
And that is the team radio of Esteban Ocon bemoaning his luck because maybe he didn't quite manage to get through before the yellow flag came in. And he was the only driver that was trying to improve there right at the end. So no one else really managed to improve.
Norris had the option. Norris had the tyres and the time to deliver. He just had a big moment in the middle sector. And then after that, Fernando Alonso cost him the second effort at a lap.
Also worth saying, the Mercedes drivers were out on the medium and they did do a lap time that was more than good enough.
A disaster, the group. Complete disaster for...
So that's the team radio of Pierre Gasly, Esteban Ocon's teammate, who has got through in 13th place. So you're at the top 15. Verstappen, Piastri jumped up to second. Then it's Ricciardo, Leclerc, Bottas, Perez, Hamilton, Sainz, Albon, Alonso, Tsunoda, Russell, Gasly, Hülkenberg and Joe. They are through. Alonso spun in a very un-Fernando Alonso fashion, I have to say, coming out of turn three. No one else could improve, and that is why we have those five out. But the incident is under investigation. Verstappen and Russell for impeding in the pit lane. Now, you're right, Alex. Verstappen was investigated in Singapore and he was found guilty to the tune of a reprimand in Singapore. We just saw a shot of Russell parked up at the end of the pit lane. I haven't seen the Verstappen one, but I imagine they're waiting for space and that has bunched up all those drivers behind.
So Russell was in front of Verstappen. I think I saw his Russell's radio.
The sergeant's still pushing 3 seconds behind. So keep pushing.
Yeah, but he's gone through a yellow flag.
So it looked to me like Russell was in front of Verstappen, he moved off, and then Verstappen stayed where he was, blocking the rest of the field behind him in the pit lane, which is exactly what he did in Singapore. And he, as you say, Julian, he got a reprimand, but the other drivers felt that that was not allowed and it should have been a penalty.
Where does the consistency lie?
Exactly.
When you've had a decision just three races ago that favoured the world champion on that day. So,
well, those decisions were discussed by the drivers at the following race. So it's the question of what happened in that discussion between the drivers and the stewards then.
And that same driver is under investigation again right now, as is George Russell, who seemed to be at the front of that queue from what we saw. There are other issues being investigated as well. One is for drivers going too quick or failing to slow under the yellow flags. One of those that is being investigated is Lewis Hamilton. George Russell was the radio that you just heard saying that Logan Sargeant went through the yellow flags. I do wonder if Esteban Ocon did the same to try and get through Q1 as well in desperation.
There were a huge number of drivers who passed that yellow flag incident, and as I looked down to our, we didn't have him in shot, but as I looked down to that yellow flag incident, Esteban Ocon was still within the first sector. So the question is, has he cleared the yellow flag and just made it through ahead, or has he passed that yellow flag zone? The stewards will be on top of that and checking it.
Sargeant now formally under investigation for failing to slow under the yellow flag. So that will be a penalty coming if the FIA deem that he did not back off accordingly for the yellow flags that were out for a spin for Fernando Alonso, who's having a tough time in the Aston Martin, but with spinning, he prevented anyone else from trying to improve, and he's through in 10th place. And that was a weird Fernando Alonso spin, a nothing spin. He didn't whack the apex too hard at turn three. He just simply lost control, and he's a driver that usually has fairly cat-like reactions.
Are you implying something, Jolene? Do you remember there was a race in Hungary a good few years ago when he was at McLaren, and actually McLaren was struggling at the time, and he also had a spin in that qualifying session, and that locked his place in for the next session, and his teammate Jenson Button, I think at the time, was knocked out, and there was a lot of speculation at the time as to whether Alonso had done it deliberately.
And I remember a qualifying session just last year in Baku where he mysteriously went into the runoff area, brought out a yellow flag, no one could improve in Q2, and I have to say, looked pretty dodgy to me as well. The spin, hey, we've not had a lot of data. It was just, all I'm saying, a strange looking spin, don't you think, Alex?
It was a strange looking spin. I think that it was an error rather than anything sinister, to be honest. And we've seen that Aston Martin looking pretty evil throughout this weekend. So he did spin in FP2, albeit at higher speed and not in a similar way.
Yeah, maybe just having a moment, taking his eye off the ball for Fernando Alonso at the end of Q1. We're into Q2 now. 14 minutes and 12 seconds left on the clock. Two cars are out, the two Red Bulls. Sergio Perez out ahead of Max Verstappen. This is a replay of Logan Sargeant at the end of Q1. Oh, he most certainly goes through a yellow flag. Not only that, but he keeps it buried just 1 metre away from the Aston Martin causing the yellow flag, pointing the wrong way.
Fernando Alonso pointing towards Logan Sargeant as he exits the right-hander of turn three, and Logan Sargeant is up against the curb, metres from the nose cone of Fernando Alonso. Lewis Hamilton heads into that first sector, and I believe there is a light panel out there, because when he passes, there's a car, Fernando Alonso is turning around on the grass by the time Lewis Hamilton gets out there, but there's not a yellow flag on that left-hand light panel, but Fernando Alonso is still basically having his moment on the right-hand side.
He's getting going again when Hamilton comes through on the right-hand side. So Hamilton's one is an arguable case.
But there's definitely not a light panel illuminated on the left-hand side on the way into turn one, while there is still a car travelling at nowhere near racing speed.
Yeah, I didn't see it. The track looked clear as well from Hamilton's point of view from the cockpit until you come round turn two and see the green Aston Martin on the green grass. And there is Alonso, but he's pointing the right way at that point. He's rejoining the action. But Sargeant, keeping his foot buried,
yeah,
looking, I mean, he's a metre away from having a head-on with Alonso. That, the stewards, I dare say, will not take lightly. This is the sound of the two Red Bulls, or the sound of Sergio Perez's Red Bull, more precisely, coming through the middle sector. They've gone out early on the soft tyres, and they are wanting to make this one a little easier to get through than the end of that Q1.
I suspect they've seen the end of last session and thought, let's get on with this. Let's make sure we get our laps in. Max Verstappen is eclipsing Sergio Perez in everything but volume of cheer on this lap. Sergio Perez taking to the exit curb on the way through the final corner and opening the DRS to the line. It is an 18.1, but Max Verstappen is flying through the middle sector of the lap, purple in almost every micro sector, over Sergio Perez, arcing the car into the final corner and letting it go. This is surely going to be a spectacular lap from Verstappen, and it is.
Half a second clear of Sergio Perez. It's the fastest lap of the weekend then so far for Max Verstappen. He's on to a 1 minute 17.6, and finally the track looks like it's starting to to come to the drivers. The grip in Q1 looked very, very low. Drivers struggling. Gasly was on the radio saying, what is going on? And now Verstappen is finding it. Loads of cars out on track now. 14 of the 15 cars are out on circuit. Just Alex Albon is in the pits waiting his turn. And this is the sound of George Russell. DRS open, hitting the brakes, turning it into the first corner in the Mercedes. Kissing the apex nicely on the right-hand side. And now he'll exit the corner, ask where Fernando Alonso had his spin, press the DRS button again and head up towards turn four.
350 kilometers per hour down towards that first corner, but down to turn four it's only 80. Second gear for George Russell, points the car right, and then it's a tiny squirt of throttle down towards turn six, where you've got to be so accurate in second gear again before opening the Mercedes up to take it into the turn seven, avoid the nasty curve on the inside and the outside, and flat out through turn nine, out of it again through the mid corner of turn 10, and the curves are very unfriendly. George Russell makes his way past traffic on the right hand side. One of the Ferraris going slowly. It's incredibly late through the mid corner of turn 11, and it's only the technical stuff to go.
That's the Ferrari of Charles Leclerc that jumped out of the way of Russell, got out of the way of the Mercedes, who are split by not very much through the first two parts. But Russell's understeering through turn 16, may lose a little bit of time there as Daniel Ricciardo's also flying in the AlphaTauri. Russell crosses the line, 7/10 adrift of Max Verstappen, 1:18.3. What about Lewis Hamilton? 10 minutes left in Q2. We've got another set of tyres to come to try and make it into the top 10. And Hamilton is 18,000 slower than Russell.
But the man who's on a fabulous lap is Ricciardo, and a fabulous lap it is as he crosses the line to go second in the AlphaTauri ahead of home hero Perez.
Ricciardo has got some pace this weekend. He's absolutely dialed in and he's up into second. So it's Verstappen, Ricciardo, Perez, Russell, Hamilton, Alonso, the six drivers so far. Oscar Piastri now down to the left-hander in the Forosol Baseball Stadium. Clambers over the curves through turns 14 and 15. Through the final real corner at 16, he's fighting the power, trying to get through turn 17 in the McLaren, and he's up into the top two once again. So Piastri comes through, quarter of a second down on Max Verstappen.
Sainz absolutely nowhere in the middle sector. 7/10 of a second down. He's being slowly demoted down the table without a time on the board and needs to find something. The Ferrari not looking dialed in, almost looking like he's on old tyres at this stage. Leclerc on the road just behind him. Carlos Sainz only managing to find seventh in a very lackluster early lap for the Scuderia.
But you're spot on. Used tyres for the Ferraris. You've got a keen eye, Alex Brundle. Seventh and eighth goes Sainz ahead of Charles Leclerc. Also used tyres at this stage for Nico Hülkenberg and Pierre Gasly, who are 10th and 11th at the moment. Alonso tumbles down to 13th as Zhou jumps up to 10th. And this is the sound of Alex Albon in the Williams understeering his way through turn 10. The car that was lightning quick in practice earlier on has fallen away dramatically, fights the car again coming into turn 12. The rear's not happy this time.
Zero steer on the way into turn 12, and he's actually in opposite lock through the mid corner of 13. It's not looking so friendly for the driver who was so fast throughout the weekend so far. Alex Albon crosses the line only 11th, and he was under pressure in Q1, looks to be under pressure again in Q2.
That Williams looked like an absolute dog as we picked it up for the second half of the lap. We wondered if he might be challenging Verstappen today, might be getting in amongst the Red Bulls, but he was fighting the front end for turn 11 on the limit of the rear into turn 12, the faster corner, then probably the rear tyre's overheating and he's struggling again.
This is no way, there's damage or something.
It looks horrendous.
There's no way it handles this badly. It must be broken, basically, says Alex Albon, who's been feeling the car much, much better than that throughout the weekend so far. The sound you can hear is Charles Leclerc, who's sitting in ninth position and very much under pressure, only a tenth behind his teammate, though.
Well, that was a new set of tyres for Albon as well. He's 1.2 seconds adrift of what he managed in the same car in practice earlier on.
Qualifying lull. Alex Albon, Hülkenberg, Gasly, Alonso and Tsunoda are your drivers under pressure. Zhou Guan Yu again, the driver on the edge of the drop zone. And then it's the two Ferraris. So all to play for that little gaggle as they head through to try to make their way into Q3.
Used tyres as a reminder for the Ferraris. But Albon, where is this pace gone for him? Same car, new tyres, track temperature's come up a little bit, and has that taken the Williams into a hideous place when earlier on Looked like they were shoo-in for Q3.
I just don't seem to understand it. The same way that we don't understand the way whether Williams are going to be strong or weak at a circuit. And from all of the radio messages we hear from Alexander Albon, he sounds as lost as we are with regards to whether that car, why that car is delivering performance or not.
Yeah. I have to say, this is the performance you would expect from Williams. You know, 11th in Q2, not really, probably not going to make it into Q1 in a Williams at Mexico City, which requires maximum downforce. It was before that was anomalous, not now.
I know, but it was rapid though, wasn't it?
Yeah, I know.
It was genuinely quick. And if everyone else is running at a similar pace than they were doing earlier, and Albon's pace has fallen off a cliff, but he's got 6 minutes to try and resurrect something to get into the top 10. With 6 minutes left to go, all 15 drivers still in qualifying are in the pit lane. Verstappen is top from Piastri, Ricciardo flying up in third, then it's Perez, Bottas, Russell, Hamilton, Sainz, Leclerc and Zhou currently through in the top 10. Albon sits 11th ahead of Hülkenberg, Gasly, Alonso 14th, having a tough day in the other Aston Martin. His teammate Lance Stroll out in 18th, and Yuki Tsunoda hasn't left the pits yet in Q2. Will presumably try and do the teammate role and ensure Daniel Ricciardo at this stage gets into Q3, because as a reminder, Tsunoda will start from the back of the grid tomorrow, whatever happens.
Well, he's only made it through to Q3 once in the last 12 races, but the further they can get him through qualifying, the more help he can be to Daniel Ricciardo with that new power unit in the car. And they'll be trying to extend that toe as far through qualifying for Daniel Ricciardo using the car of Yuki Tsunoda as they can.
So the bottom five at the moment: Albon, Hülkenberg, Gasly, Alonso and Tsunoda. A pretty routine five at the moment. Alpine really struggling this weekend. Both cars were in the top 10 in qualifying last week, but around this circuit, they're not having a great time of it. Ocon out in 16th, Gasly at the moment in 13th. On the cusp is Zhou in the Alfa Romeo in 10th. That car's looking pretty handy. Bottas has been flying all weekend, his teammate, up in 5th position, and they'll be looking to get two cars through into the top 10, which would be a cracking achievement. And the first time they've done that since the Hungarian Grand Prix. Under a bit of pressure then is Russell 6th, Hamilton 7th, and more importantly, Sainz 8th and Leclerc 9th, just a little bit closer to the edge. The time's so close, only 1/10 separates the four of them. And they've got to find a little bit of a pace, because track will evolve, the times will drop.
I think the nature of the way this race is going to play out strategically, we're expecting a one stopper based around the hard and the medium, has meant that a lot of the practice running has had to go on this soft tyre. So we're getting a mixed up early run in these sessions because of the varying tyres that the drivers are using to try to set their lap as they all charge out onto the pit lane. I think Yuki Tsunoda may have clattered a piece of pit equipment there as he headed out of a garage.
So he's also under investigation for overtaking under the yellow flags, Yuki Tsunoda, as is Logan Sargeant. That's all a repercussion of Fernando Alonso's spin. 3.5 minutes left on the clock, more precisely 3 minutes 31, 30, 29, as we come towards the final lap of Q2. This is the sound on board the Japanese driver in the AlphaTauri. Yuki Tsunoda almost idling his way out of the pit lane, staring at the back of his teammate Daniel Ricciardo, who he will surely try and slipstream into the top 10.
And we are just seeing it again in the commentary box. As Yuki Tsunoda came out, he wipes a jack out, what looks like a jack, into the middle of the pit lane there.
One of the mechanics just having a little smirk as he watched on and saw that all unfold. The jack was out. They're quite tight, the pit lanes.
It's another mess leaving the pit lane again.
And they're going to have a discussion about this, because you can manage it for driving. Basically, as a result of what happened in Singapore, drivers feel like they've got the green light to do this, don't they? And not only are they really managing each other's run plans by doing this, also, tyre temperature and pressure is an incredibly tightly controlled thing in Formula One. And you can manipulate it by just parking the car at the end of the pit lane and letting the tyre cool on the way down.
So as we had at the end of Q1, with Russell and Verstappen slowing up at the end of the pit lane, coming to a full halt, more drivers doing it at the end of Q2 as well. Zhou, certainly, we have seen, was an offender, but there probably were others as well, as the queue of cars still waiting at the end of the pit lane. They're all being released now. Sergio Perez at the back of the queue. Max Verstappen still in the pit. Less than 2 minutes to go. And here we go then. On to the final runs of Q2. The Ferrari's under pressure. And Carlos Sainz screams his way down to the first corner. DRS open. Flat track down to the braking zone. He'll hit 214, 215, 16 miles per hour. Huge top speeds here at the Mexico City circuit. And he comes through. Turn one. Bounces over the curb. The left-hander at turn two. And then it's important to get that clean exit up towards turn four, out of turn three. DRS open again, and another big smash of the brake pedal. Big lock up for Sainz though. Left front is locked, and he's managed to get it turned into turn four still. But Alex, I reckon he's lost a little bit of time there.
Scrabbled it into the apex of turn four, but he was a little bit too wide. He needs to be right over the curb there for Sainz. On the second time, the thin air of Mexico City was allowed through the DRS flap in the middle of his wing. Sainz though, connecting the apexes beautifully through the middle sector. Is it going to be enough to recoup the loss of going far too deep into four?
Hülkenberg jumps up to the top 10. So Hülkenberg sneaks up to 10th. Sainz is 7/10 down in the middle sector. He's lost time with that mistake. He hits the brakes again for the left-hander at turn 13. Leclerc is doing a much better job in the other Ferrari. He's 6/10 up on Sainz. He's 1/10 down on Max Verstappen. Now the Ferrari's on the soft tyre. And here comes Sainz now driving to the line, and he doesn't improve. Carlos Sainz is in trouble here. 8th position, but everyone behind him is seeking an improvement, and the first one to do so is his teammate Charles Leclerc, who goes straight up to P3.
Yeah, much better lap for Charles Leclerc. There's also a lovely lap coming from George Russell, who's heading through the final sector now in his Mercedes. You can hear Pierre Gasly, who's on a much, much better lap for Alpine as well.
Ricciardo goes second, Bottas goes fifth. Drivers are improving in the drop zone. Joe, Alonso, Albon, Gasly and Tsunoda all there. Tsunoda has pitted. He's done. He's just helping his teammate. This is the sound of Pierre Gasly out of the final corner, oversteering now towards the line. The Frenchman down in 14th position gets through. He's up into 10th for now, but Joe is also improving in the Alfa Romeo.
Lewis Hamilton on target for a gorgeous lap in the Mercedes. He is up on what Max Verstappen has achieved so far, but the driver at risk now is Guan Yu Zhou. Lewis Hamilton goes P1.
Gasly is out 11th. Hülkenberg is out in 12th. Fernando Alonso is out there and not improving in 13th. It's all on Alex Albon in the Williams. Here he comes, coaxing his Williams into the left-hander at turn 13. Still looking for the grip, still fighting the rear end. It's Albon or Zhou. Zhou currently in 10th. Albon now exits the final corner. The Williams hugs to the inside, shorts the distance, and he's through. Albon up into 9th position. He's got himself into the top 10, and is Guan Yu Zhou dropping out in 11th place. A brilliant final last lap from Alex Albon then.
Alex Albon, with a difficult car underneath him, manages to find a lap, but only just to get the Williams through and out of Q2. Carlos Sainz on the absolute brink after that error early on in qualifying. Will just escape demotion.
Yeah, Sainz, oh, he got away with that one. Big lockup into turn four. We said before, you really can't afford to make a mistake when the times are this close and you've got yourself under pressure without a first banker lap in. Well, he just about got away with a mistake like that. Out in Q2, it's Zhou, Gasly, Hülkenberg, Alonso 14th, and Tsunoda, who is 15th, but will start from the back tomorrow. Alonso, very, very lackluster again. And Aston Martin, both out in Q1 for the Grand Prix qualifying last week. Alonso's got himself through into Q2, but in a strange Q1 session with his own spin. Here's Joe.
Okay, Joe, we finish P11. P11.
Wow, it was less than a tenth of a second for Joe, but that's the difference. Even the man who eventually ended up first in the session, for what it's worth, was on the brink before he did so. That's the nature of that final lap for Hamilton, put him to the top of the times, but he could easily, if he'd have messed it out, tumbled down out of the top 10.
Yeah, that's the peril of qualifying on a short circuit with the time so close. Hamilton hooked it up, has hit the front. He's done the fastest lap of the weekend so far, but Verstappen didn't go back out at the end of Q2. So you'd have thought there's more in there for the triple champ. Hamilton, Verstappen, Russell, Ricciardo still flying up in fourth place. Piastri fifth, Leclerc sixth. Bottas has done a great job this weekend and he's through in seventh. Perez is eighth. Albon through at the last gasp in ninth position. And Sainz snuck through as well. Although, Alex, lap time deleted. Alex Albon.
Oh. And That's yet to play out on our timing screens, but surely that then demotes Alex Albon out of this stage of qualifying.
It will do. All of that last gasp effort, and he's gone for cutting turn two. So I think that's the apex curb at turn two that Albon has gone over, and that will cost him his Q3 berth.
He must have really ramped it then, because normally your rear tyre is on until your front tyre is on those apex curb cuts, but he must have been right over the apex curb of two.
Just when you thought track limits couldn't play a part around this circuit, they found an apex to Müller, and Albon slips then from ninth place in Q2 to 14th, and he is out. It's a reprieve for Zhou, and Alfa Romeo have two cars in the top 10.
Now, look, it's been a remarkable performance from Daniel Ricciardo so far, but I'm really interested to see what he can do in this last session, because I'm pretty sure he's had a tow from Yuki Tsunoda on every single one of his laps so far, including the first one in Q2, by the way. Tsunoda did go out to do an out and an in to tow Ricciardo. So what's he going to be able to do without the tow? I suspect he won't be fourth by the end of the session.
With the tow, he's just over one-tenth off the outright pace in the AlphaTauri. It's a remarkable job he's done with the help of a slipstream from his teammate, who will start from the back and has sacrificed his qualifying to help the 8-time Grand Prix winner, his Australian teammate. Ricciardo's in the top 10. What can he do? What do you expect that to cost him?
Interestingly, though, there is one sector where Daniel Ricciardo is the fastest of anyone in that second qualifying session. That sector is not the first one. It's the final one where he really appears to be nailing it. So as we listen in to Alex Albon, and it must have been so marginal. He really does take the inside curb of turn two, but it's imperceivable whether he is all the way off the road or not.
You need a slow-mo shot for whether the front right is back in touch with the tarmac before the rear right is off the track. The FIA, I assume, have got this, and they've seen it, and they've decided that Albon is out. He's gesticulating now.
He's looking at it in the garage. They've freeze-framed it for him, and he is debating it with his engineer in the garage.
Stewards are busy. There's now an incident involving the Williams equipment that's investigated.
Could be what Yuki Tsunoda hit as he went out into the pit lane, so Williams would get in trouble for leaving equipment in an unsafe place.
It definitely was Williams equipment, yeah.
Well, there you go. That will be that, and that'll be probably why the AlphaTauri mechanic was looking slightly bemused as to trouble when the jack was hit.
Just give that. You're going to be out of qualifying anyway, Yuki. Just give that jack a clout, would you?
Yeah, you've done a great job with Daniel so far. Give him one more place and give that one a nudge. And that'll be I would expect that to be a team fine more than anything else for Williams. So the slipstream, what do you reckon? A tenth maybe on this long straight that Ricciardo might have benefited?
Oh, well, let me just quantify the millibars of how much thinner the air is here and decide how much less of a tow you get.
70% of the oxygen, but it's almost a kilometre down to the first corner.
Yeah, it's 70% of the oxygen, but there's other gases in air, JP. It's not all
that's
oxygen.
True.
But I tell you, we'd be having a great time if it was. You couldn't run any cars, though. That'd be a little bit
So what are you getting more of? Nitrogen?
Nothing, are you? The molecules are just further apart. There's less air pressure. Come on, buddy. GCSE physics.
Chief F1 writer Andrew Benson.
I'm not sure you need even GCSE physics to know that. It's just
BBC scientist.
It's the air
Alex
that's
Brundle.
Thinner, Jolyon, not the oxygen that's thinner. Well, it's all thinner. Every component part, including
so the
nitrogen and the helium and sort of the carbon dioxide and everything else.
There's helium in air. Oh, okay.
Oh, I thought you were doing so well on the science thing. It was. I bought everything you said until you questioned if there was helium in the air.
Oh, I thought it was only in
the balloons. Did you go to school?
I did. Briefly. In between races.
I was never good at science.
Yeah.
I'll leave it at that. This is why we have Andrew Benson in the commentary box, to correct us when we don't know the air density.
Keep us on topic.
Still, the Mexican crowd, they are loving it here. Every time that we've got no cars on track, you can just hear the chants of the crowd. They've got their Mexican driver, Sergio Perez, into the top 10. They've willed him into the top 10. He's done a great job at the wheel as well. And Perez will make a bid to get onto pole position for the first time around this circuit. Seven different drivers have taken pole here. There has never been a repeat pole sitter in the modern running of this Grand Prix. We've had Nico Rosberg, we've had Lewis Hamilton, Sebastian Vettel, Daniel Ricciardo, Charles Leclerc, Valtteri Bottas and Max Verstappen in the last seven runnings of the Mexican Grand Prix. Seven runnings because there was no Grand Prix here in 2020 when COVID hit. So that goes back to 2015. Verstappen, the man to beat. Hamilton has had pole, Ricciardo has, Leclerc has and Bottas has. So five of the 10 drivers left in can ruin that stat.
So here's a question. If Verstappen gets pole on the track, which he obviously will, it would seem, what happens if he gets disqualified from pole for a penalty for impeding in the pit lane? Does he get pole or not?
Well, that's a very good question. According to my stats, no, he doesn't, because he did that already in 2019 when he improved under a yellow flag and that went to Charles Leclerc's pole. So
this is actually cured and solved by a point situation where, for example, in feeder series, drivers get points for pole. And those points are only awarded when they start from pole. The points are awarded for starting from pole, not for achieving the pole position. So that clears that one up.
I'm on board with that. The sprint format really changed the meaning of pole,
because that's the rules.
Yeah. Well, the sprint changed what a pole position was, didn't it? When Kevin Magnussen was awarded pole, but he didn't start the Grand Prix from pole in Brazil last year. But the drivers thought the fastest lap would be the pole, even if you got taken away. And Michael Schumacher in 2012 in Monaco, and that epic lap that didn't count, that should have done. The debate rages on.
If Verstappen scores pole, it would be his 11th of the year and the best ever total poles. In terms of a season, 10 poles, which would be rather impressive.
He's racking up the records, isn't he? He is, and he is still the man to beat. We're into Q3, 10.5 minutes left on the clock, and we are winding it up for the first attempt. Nine cars out on circuit. Joe stays in the pit lane, having scraped his way into this final part of qualifying. And the first man roaring his way down to the first corner, the kilometre-long straight in very, very thin air with a little bit less oxygen, is Sergio Perez, who hits the brakes now, mashes his left foot against the brake pedal. You can hear the crowd every single time this driver comes through, particularly turns 1, 2 and 3 and the final sector, where they are willing him on the whole way. And now he heads up towards turn 4, moving his car to the right-hand side, straight line braking in towards the apex, and Perez is through there quite cleanly.
They certainly seem to have plenty of breath, don't they, down at turn 6. Let's see if Perez can avoid the issues that he had on his lap in Q2. He's already made it through turn 4. Now there's the peril of 7 through to 8, where we've seen so many drivers have issues on the aggressive curve. Verstappen is slightly up on what Perez has managed to achieve through the first sector alone. There are plenty of drivers behind him improving as well.
Verstappen 2/10 quicker than Perez in the first sector. Bottas is quicker than Perez in the first sector as well. Ricciardo is quicker than Perez. It's not a great first sector for Sergio Perez, but he's coming through to complete the lap now. Comes around the Mercedes of Lewis Hamilton, who's just ending his outlap. The crowd's still cheering, but this is not about to be putting the cat amongst the pigeons for Sergio Perez. Verstappen is quicker again than Perez in the middle sector. The Mexican comes across the line and racks in a 1:17.8. But what about his teammate? He's done the fastest middle sector of anyone, beaten now by Daniel Ricciardo, who's on a monster lap in the AlphaTauri. Here's the three-time world champion, Max Verstappen, coming across the line. 1:17.2, the fastest lap of the weekend. A big, big benchmark. He's half a second quicker than his teammate.
It's a gorgeous lap, though, from Daniel Ricciardo. We'll see what he does when he comes across the line. He's in the final sector now, up to second for Ricciardo in the AlphaTauri.
Does he need a slipstream? Does he ever? He's only 1/10 down on Max Verstappen's time. Ricciardo's up into second. Can anyone demote him off the provisional front row? What about the Ferraris? Leclerc's on the fastest first sector. Carlos Sainz comes through, goes quicker than Verstappen. Monster lap from Sainz, and Leclerc's going even quicker. Leclerc comes out of the final corner. The Monegasque driver drives to the line himself, and he's quicker than Sainz. Leclerc on provisional pole. There's 8 minutes left. There's time for another run. It's a Ferrari 1-2.
Piastri not looking quick enough. He's only up to sixth for the Australian driver, and neither are the two Mercedes who are coming through the final sector now. Both improving. George Russell looking like a mid-top 10 time. It's up to fifth for George. Lewis Hamilton will be the final driver of those running to set a time. He's going to come across the line. It will be good enough for sixth.
So after the first runs, Charles Leclerc, out of nowhere, who's been talking down their prospects all weekend, leads a Ferrari 1-2. Fred Vasseur is chatting to his engineers, saying, how are we here, guys? But it's real. 7.5 minutes left on the clock, and crucially, one more pole chance for everyone else. Leclerc leads a Ferrari 1-2. Verstappen is third. We're getting a replay of Max Verstappen through the middle sector.
Is there an error somewhere in the middle sector which has cost Max Verstappen this time? Looks neat and tidy enough to me, JP.
So, Verstappen got on the radio and said, when I box, check the floor at the front, because he went over the curb at turn eight. Wasn't sure if that radio was going to play out. It didn't, but there we go. Verstappen said, check the front of the floor because he went over the curb. Didn't look too bad, though.
Didn't look any worse than he's been doing all the way through free practice. So both Ferraris arrive at the front of the field, and there looked to be a decent amount of surprise on their pit wall, even between the engineers and Fred Vasseur there, but they find themselves with a why are we so fast scenario. Max Verstappen with it all to do. Daniel Ricciardo really demonstrating brilliant form in the AlphaTauri, and that's the battle we've got after the first run of Q3. 6 minutes and 27 seconds remain.
So just something to bear in mind, Russell, Hamilton and Perez were all on used tyres for that run, so they've all got quite a lot to find on this run in theory.
So Leclerc top from Sainz and Verstappen, Ricciardo fourth, then there is half a second to George Russell and Lewis Hamilton. Russell ahead of Hamilton, the two Mercedes fifth and sixth, separated by just 12 thousandths, and they were on used tyres. Perez is seventh, also on used tyres, 6 tenths down on Charles Leclerc. Then it's Piastri and Bottas. Zhou has not done a lap, but that is the sound you can hear now, the Alfa Romeo through the middle sector, and he's got the track to himself for his run. The rest of the 10 cars, nine others, are in the pits waiting for a final flourish. And Charles Leclerc, out of nowhere, has laid down a real gauntlet for Ferrari. Carlos Sainz also hooking up a brilliant lap. It's Ferrari 1-2. The Perez fans haven't got the memo. He's down in seventh at the moment. They still want the home driver to try and make his way up towards the top ten. He's sitting in the pits. They know it's a telemetry sheet.
They know it was on used tyres. You see, that's why they're still so excited. They're out there going, used tyres, just wait till he gets on the new ones like Verstappen's just had.
Used tyre delta. Could be a few tenths. Mercedes will be hoping it's worth half a second. That's at the moment what they're off. Joe starts a flying lap in the Alfa Romeo then. Valtteri Bottas' teammate, ninth of the nine runners, but he's within 9 tenths of the pace as well. So the time's still fairly close. Bottas also was on a used set of tyres, so there'll be more to come from the Finn. Piastri and the McLaren down in eight. So McLaren having a tricky weekend of it so far on a circuit they didn't expect to be particularly strong at, but Norris down at the back of the field, as a reminder tomorrow, didn't hook up a single lap in three attempts in Q1. Lando Norris has his work cut out. The rest of the main players are still in this qualifying session. 4.5 minutes remain. It is just Zhou who's sliding his way through the middle sector. A little bit twitchy at the rear end through turn nine.
Sure is. Both Alfa Romeos, though, making their way through to Q3 in an impressive effort. Daniel Ricciardo sitting in what would be AlphaTauri's best grid position of the year, sitting in fourth position. They've not been better than eighth so far this year. That was with Tsunoda earlier on in the season. Let's see what Zhou can do. Could well be his only run in Q3 due to the amount of tyres he has left. It's up to ninth for Zhou Guanyu, clear of his teammate Valtteri Bottas at this stage.
And that'll be why he went in the middle there, because that is Zhou done. No more tyres, no more pace. Zhou in ninth. 4 thousandths quicker than Bottas, but Bottas is leaving the pits now with the rest of them on a set of new tyres. 3:45 left on the clock. Plenty of time for everyone to get out and get on a flying lap. Carlos Sainz leaves the pits in the Ferrari. He's the first of the main runners to do so. Daniel Ricciardo's out in the AlphaTauri as well. Now, provisional pole man Charles Leclerc leaves the box. Verstappen waits. Perez leaves the pits. Verstappen and the two Mercedes waiting. They'll be the last across the line in today's Q3.
What have the Scuderia got under wraps? What can they pull out of the bag here? We haven't seen much of them. They've been bemoaning difficulties with the car. They've been not happy with it, certainly on the race runs. This has come from nowhere in qualifying. Verstappen's looked the class of the field. Not easily, but he's looked the class of the field in all the way through free practice. And if you're going to pick a competitor in it throughout free practice, Ferrari would definitely not have been it. But they sit there, 1-2, with 2 minutes 50 to go in Q3.
We might have gone McLaren. We might have gone Mercedes. We might even have gone Alex Albon. We would not have gone Ferrari from what we've seen. They had a really troubled final run in practice earlier on as well. Both drivers hit trouble through the middle sector, hit traffic, and Sainz actually spun the car, the last thing he did before this qualifying. Now, as he comes through the middle sector on this outlap, he sits on a provisional front row, his teammate on provisional pole, but drivers behind, particularly this man, Max Verstappen, gunning to beat him, gunning to get an 11th pole position of the season, his relentless 2023 campaign. He's won everything already. He's won the championship. He's got all the records. He's pushing for more. And Verstappen wants this pole position. But it will be Carlos Sainz then, the first driver to come through to start the flying lap. Then it's Ricciardo, the Australian, currently in fourth place, winding it up behind the Spaniard in the Ferrari, who gets on the throttle and starts his final flying lap, building the speed, hugging the left-hand side of the road down to the first corner. And Carlos Sainz will be the first man to attack Charles Leclerc's provisional pole lap.
What a Grand Prix this would be if the pair of Ferraris could gang up on Max Verstappen throughout the race distance and really make him work for this victory. Sainz is absolutely hauling the car through those first three corners and all over the curbs. DRS is open, braking point is nailed, but it's not an improvement. He's almost a tenth down in sector one, Carlos Sainz, so he's going to have to find something. The area of the circuit where he lost out in the first run to Max Verstappen was through this middle sector. Let's see if he can improve as he commits the front of the Ferrari into turn seven.
Leclerc not improving either through the first sector, but they're both still up on Daniel Ricciardo, who is improving in the first sector. Ricciardo's quicker through the second and third. He's currently the fastest man in the second and third sector. So Ricciardo gunning for the pole lap as well. Sainz is 2/10 down as he swings it through turn 12 and enters the baseball stadium. This is not looking like an improvement for Carlos Sainz, and it will open the door for Ricciardo, for Verstappen as well, to try and get in amongst the Ferraris, because Leclerc's not improving either.
Verstappen is improving on his personal best, but he's not clearing what was done earlier in this session yet. Ricciardo still to come across the line. Let's see if he's got anything in the tank. No, 3/10 down on what he previously did.
Sainz doesn't improve. Ricciardo doesn't improve either. Verstappen does the fastest middle sector on this final lap. Leclerc comes through. He's 6/10 adrift. No improvement at all from the Monegas driver. That's the sound of Sergio Perez through. He's up into fifth place. But what about Max Verstappen, the champion, the three-time world champion, on pole here last year? Slides his way out of the final corner. He comes across the line, and it's not enough for Max Verstappen. It's going to be Charles Leclerc on pole position in Mexico. The Ferrari garage cheer, but there's still two Mercedes out there on brand new tyres pushing for it.
Russell not seeming to improve at the moment. It's Lewis Hamilton who has a better lap in the tank. We'll see Russell across the line first. He's heading into turn 12 right now and slowing the car into turn 13. Hamilton a tenth down, but will move forward in the Mercedes. Russell now improving on his previous best.
Leclerc, Sainz and Verstappen, the top three separated by less than a tenth. Here comes George Russell to try and get in the mix in the Mercedes, and it's not enough. Seventh for Russell. But Hamilton is going quicker in the other Mercedes. Quicker, but is it enough? It is not. It is sixth position for Lewis Hamilton only. The Mercedes sixth and eighth. And it is to the joy and jubilation of Ferrari and Fred Vasseur as handshakes on the pit wall. It's a 1-2 for Ferrari in Mexico. Charles Leclerc is on pole position. And the crowd, in spite of not having a Sergio Perez top three, they're loving it. Ferrari 1-2. We've well and truly got a race on our hands tomorrow.
First Ferrari 1-2 since the middle of 2022 in Monaco. And what a fantastic performance.
And P1.
Good job. Good job, guys. Well, that's a surprise. I feel like every pole we do this year is a surprise, but good surprise. Now, go on, let's do it tomorrow.
Good job, Charlie.
I'm glad he's surprised, because I think everyone in the paddock is surprised. That was the voice of Fred Vasseur. Typically few words from Fred there over the team radio, but he could be pleased. He has overseen in his first year as team principal a Grand Prix win for Carlos Sainz in Singapore, and now he's got 1-2 on the grid at the Mexican Grand Prix. Charles Leclerc brings his car in next to the P1 board, and he has a little fist bump, a little pat of the front right tyre, and he looks like a man who is trying to take it all in. He's on pole position. We have a second pole sitter, second time pole sitter at the Mexican Grand Prix. And it is not the man we thought would do it. It is Charles Leclerc who has taken pole position. Behind him, Carlos Sainz second. Max Verstappen will line up third for tomorrow's race. Daniel Ricciardo, superb, clung on to fourth in the AlphaTauri. A standout result for him. And as Sergio Perez, Lewis Hamilton sixth, Piastri seventh, Russell eighth. Bottas got back ahead of Zhou in the Alfa Romeo battle at the bottom end of the top 10. Not much separating those two, ninth and 10th. but it is all smiles and waves to the crowd for Charles Leclerc and Ferrari. They've given themselves a real, real shot.
They really have. Ending FP3, one car flat spotted, one car backwards, 13th and 15th on the timing screen. They end qualifying 1 and 2. And what a race we have in prospect on what's one of the longest runs of the year, down towards turn one. Max Verstappen, with all of the aggression that he can muster, is going to have a real job to do against this pair of flying teammates.
Verstappen, helmet on, jumped on the scales and went over to congratulate his former teammate Daniel Ricciardo, who has had a superb qualifying session here as well. Ferrari teammates chatting. Carlos Sainz also smirking and smiling.
Fastest in that first sector for Charles Leclerc. Max Verstappen came back at him in the middle. It's still Daniel Ricciardo who's strung together the best of the final sector, but the Ferrari seems to be lightning down that front straight and in the mechanical sector of the lap, and that's what's given it to them, along with a sterling performance by their two drivers, and two-thirds of a tenth in it at the end of the day.
No improvement on the final laps, but they didn't need it, the two Ferrari drivers. Charles Leclerc on pole position, Carlos Sainz alongside him. Sainz and Verstappen, also former teammates, having a chat now. We can hear from the top three. They're speaking to James Hinchcliffe down there.
Charles Leclerc, incredible result for you and Ferrari, back-to-back pole positions. I don't think after practice there were many people in the paddock that would have put money on an all-Ferrari front row. Do you include yourself in that group, or did you guys know you had this kind of pace?
Absolutely not. Then it's been 2 weekends in a row where we say that, so then people will start not believing us anymore. But to be honest, I did not expect to be on pole position today. We thought we were lacking quite a bit after FP3. But for some reason, once we put everything together, it went well. The new tyres, we gained a lot. But I'm already focusing on tomorrow's race, because many pole position, but now we need to convert it in a win tomorrow. And of course, it's going to be very difficult.
So obviously, that wasn't the case last week. Strategy maybe not going your way. What do you have to do different tomorrow to convert this pole to a win?
Well, just focusing on ourselves, and we've had a pretty good pace all weekend. I'm not sure whether it's enough to be challenging for the win, but we'll try everything in our hands to try and get it, and let's see tomorrow.
Longest run from pole position down to turn one here, over 800 meters. Does that mean you have to approach the start or approach turn one any differently to try to maintain the lead out at the first corner?
First place here, I'm not sure it's the best starting place, but anyway, that's fine. I'm happy. I'll take that pole position. I'm really happy with today, and now let's, as I said, finalize it tomorrow.
Excellent. Well, congratulations.
Gracias.
And keeping the theme with all the drivers in red on the front row, Carlos, incredible qualifying performance from where you guys were in practice. Talk us through your session.
It was a very strange one, honestly, a whole weekend. I've struggled to put a lap together, and the first lap that I put together was at the Q3-1-1, and suddenly it was a P1 at the time, then Charles beat me by half a tenth, one tenth, but I just struggled to understand where suddenly we can find half a second and then go half a second slower in the next lap. It's very tricky with the tires, the feeling with the car is very strange around this circuit, but we managed to put a good lap when it counted, and it puts us in a good position for tomorrow.
So got it done in qualifying. Are you confident in your race pace? How was practice on full fuel, and what do you think you guys can realistically get done tomorrow?
Well, clearly we are not as strong in high fuel as we are in low fuel. I think our car benefits a lot from that new tire, soft tire peak at the rear, and we're going to see how we can do tomorrow to keep those tires alive, to keep that Red Bull behind, because having two cars in front, it's a good advantage. So yeah, we're going to try our best.
Well, hey, great result for you. Great result for Ferrari. Congratulations on a front row. Max, how are you? Difficult session out there with these track conditions. It's a low grip circuit, lowest downforce that these cars see all year. How tricky is it to get that perfect lap here in qualifying?
It's very difficult. You know, it's very low grip around here, of course, because of the altitude. So when you try to push a little bit more, it just tries to, you know, go away from you. And I think that happened a little bit, I think, in Q3, where we just couldn't put it together. Especially also the last sector, it seemed like we're struggling a little bit more than I would have liked. But nevertheless, it was still close, and it's still a very long race, and a lot of laps to be raced, and that's where, of course, you score the points.
Yeah, you've won from a various number of positions on the grid, so I got to think you're still pretty confident going into tomorrow with your race car?
I am. I mean, of course, I would have liked to start first, but we'll have a good slipstream to turn one, and we'll see what happens.
All right, odds that you're leading coming out of turn one. What do you think?
I'll give it a good go.
All right, sounds good. Congratulations.
Max Verstappen there, as well as the two Ferrari drivers, your top two and then your top three for tomorrow. Speaking with IndyCar race winner James Hinchcliffe down in Parc Fermé. Verstappen, he seems pretty happy, waving to the crowd. He'll know he's still got a chance tomorrow. Is he still favourite for tomorrow, Alex?
I think he still is, given how difficult the Ferrari's race running has been throughout FP1 and FP2. That being said, their one lap running didn't look great either, and then they've just pulled a pole and a second place out of the bag. So I think everything in terms of the form book can be thrown away by how strangely that the track is performing. We heard there about the low levels of downforce around here, catching a lot of the drivers out. That's why we're seeing so many errors out on track. And how many of those errors are there going to be tomorrow is going to be a very mixed up Grand Prix, certainly, especially when they're battling hard at the front.
Yeah, from what we saw in the long running yesterday, Ferrari were on the back foot, but we didn't think they were exactly on the front foot on the short running. They have flipped the script on Saturday in Mexico. Charles Leclerc is on pole. Carlos Sainz alongside him. It's a long run down to the first corner as well.
Extremely long run down to the first corner. So long that actually cars build speed and the toe starts to come into effect. That second phase of the start, beyond just getting off the line, shifts up towards higher speeds, and then ducking into the toe of the car ahead of you can give you an opportunity to pass down towards turn one. It's not going to be a Grand Prix with a lot of stops, we don't think. Tires are going to be running, especially the medium and the hard tire, running a long way through the Grand Prix, but it's going to be an interesting one to battle on track. Triple DRS zones here, so a fair few options to overtake, and it's going to be good battling at the front.
Ferrari's had a 1-2 at the start in Singapore as well. Carlos Sainz went on to win the Grand Prix. Tomorrow's race certain to be interesting.
Aye. B4.
All right.
Enchanté.
Enchanté, mon ami.
Welcome.
And that is the team radio of another star of the day, Daniel Ricciardo in fourth place. And it is great to see the Australian loving life back in Formula One. So that's it for today. That's it for qualifying. We are set for a thrilling Grand Prix tomorrow. Join us on BBC Radio 5 Live at 8 p.m. for Lights Out, where it will be Charles Leclerc on an all-Ferrari front row. Leclerc on pole position. We'll see you then.